You look angry.
Grr.
That's right. All right. Hey, everyone. Corey from Aquarium Co-op. Finally got Lamont back in the studio. I've been working him like a dog, so he's back. But today, real fish talk. We're going to talk about pH, alkalinity, their relationship, and probably crushed coral. I see it all the time on forums and Facebook. People ask, is crushed coral good? Is it bad? Some people say, oh, it's terrible. Some people say it's amazing. And it all has to do with what your water structure naturally is and whether you love it or hate it. And if you're in the saltwater world, maybe you hate it because it traps some debris or whatever. But, you know, we'll get to the bottom of it and explain a lot of things. And then you can decide if that's beneficial for you or not. So, all right. Let's start by explaining, explain what pH is, but I can't really explain that. I can talk about it, but I don't know that I can be like, oh, it's the specific measurement of blah, blah, blah. But, yeah, go ahead. If you're smarter than me, go ahead and take this one.
I'm not smarter than you. Well, isn't it the measurement of hydrogen ions versus hydroxyl ions? Is that the...
That sounds scientific enough. I believe that, yes.
Right. So if it's one direction, it's an excess of hydroxyl ions. And if it's the other direction, it's an excess of hydrogen ions. I think that's how it works.
Anyway. As long as one of those mates up to water's getting more acidic and one's getting more base or more alkaline, I agree. Which, that's a little too nerdy. But basically, when your pH goes up, it becomes more alkaline. When it becomes more acidic, it gets more acidic. You know, that's what it does. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to put it in perspective, like orange juice, very acidic. Milk, not acidic. And if we started mixing those two, for instance, we'd start getting somewhere in the middle. And neutral is considered 7 on that scale. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that's considered neutral for fish. But on that scale, 7 is considered neutral. 6 would be kind of low, 8 would be kind of high, and outside of those, you know, 5 and 9 would be even more outside that. And I think for the sake of argument for this episode, we'll say that like somewhere between 7.2 and 7.5 is optimal for most fish that you would buy at a store if it's been bred. Yeah, if it's been bred, if it's not wild caught, you know, and there's some outliers there. You know, some Africans will be raised in Florida and they'll have much higher pH, but like, for instance, if you were to buy the Cyprochromis I have getting ready to breed in my fish room, they're going to be bred at like 7.2 pH, and, you know, yeah, out of the wild, they'd be much, much higher, things like that. So for the sake of this discussion, neutral, 7.2 to 7.5, somewhere in there. You want to explain what alkalinity is, and then we can start explaining relationships between them.
Well, in my understanding of alkalinity, it would be essentially once you start getting a certain level, was it calcium and magnesium, and was it potassium that also changes the kinetic?
Oof, I am bad with that stuff. I just know that like alkalinity is the measurement of like how many free ions there are to bond with the byproduct of breaking down waste.
Right.
So that's technical, and I'm going to go through that a little easier now. So basically what happens when a fish goes to the bathroom, or let's say your piece of driftwood's rotting or something, bacteria, that's a better thing. It doesn't matter where the waste is coming from. When the bacteria is breaking it down, through nitrite and nitrate, the byproduct of that is, you know, let's say it's acidic ions, you know, hydronic ions. I don't know which one was which, but it acidifies the water. So when we do that, if we don't have anything to bond with that molecule, it just straight up becomes more acidic. When we have alkalinity, that's the free ions that can bond with it. And when we bond with it, it makes it so it It basically does nothing. It uses up a little bit of our alkalinity, but it doesn't change the pH one way or the other. It just stays where it was. And, you know, a way to kind of think about that I've used to explain to customers is if it's $1,000 in the bank account and every time you go to eat lunch, you take $5 out, as long as you don't run out before the next paycheck, you won't bounce a check. You won't get into trouble. But if you only have $5 in your bank account and you got to make it till next week and you got to eat lunch every day, you might only get to eat lunch once, but then the next day you eat lunch and the waste produced is now putting you into debt. And that's going to start dropping that pH. And eventually you do get paid. All right, I've got $50 in the bank account again. But it was all eaten up by overdraft fees, so the pH was already so low that when we did that water change, it didn't even bring it up that much, you know. So you might pay all the fees off and go, well, now I got $4 in the bank, and I got to buy lunch 10 more times again before I get paid. And so you can see how without enough alkalinity or buffering capacity, which is another name for that, it's kind of a vicious cycle of it gets worse. You do your water changes every week, you do your thing. And then, you know, the next week, it's getting worse, and it just continually goes down, which sucks, because then you get into old tank syndrome and things like that. But, so the relationship between those two, if we have lots of money in the bank, or alkalinity, or buffer, we can keep the pH from moving. We don't run out of money, we don't run out of ions, all right? So if we can agree on that as an easy way to think about it, then we need to know, how can we get more ions, things like that.
Correct. I mean, it's like, you know, essentially they react with each other to neutralize. They kind of cancel each other out once they bind together. So, you know, essentially, you know, like you're talking, the banking analogy. So it's basically the crushed coral is the equivalent of like the money in the bank, whereas in, you know, once water starts to become acidic, whether it's due to waste or wood or what have you, once that pH starts to drop below 7, it starts to react with the, I'm going to say the hydroxyl ions that are in the calcium and magnesium and whatnot. It reacts with that, dissolves those, but as they dissolve and enter the water column, they bind with those extra hydrogen ions, and then it starts to bring the pH back to normal. And it kind of works as a, I mean, just, I don't know, my understanding, like, once you get up to 7, then the chemical reaction starts to stop until more acidity or more hydrogen ions start to show up in the tank.
But the rate at which it happens slows down. It's kind of like, if you have $100,000 in the bank, you start calling in sick more often. You start getting lazier, and you're like, right. You're not, you know. But if you're negative $10 and you want to eat tomorrow, all of a sudden you're mowing your neighbor's lawn, and that's kind of how the crushed coral works. When it's crazy acidic, it eats away at that crushed coral, dissolving it faster. And the higher the pH gets, the slower it's going to eat away at it, to a point where, and that, you know, if we call it the melting point, so to speak. It's different on, is it Florida crushed coral? Is it Fiji crushed coral? Is it sand? Is it aragonite? Different things have different buffering points. And I've seen, you know, like let's say Florida crushed coral on a tank that hasn't had a water change in a year, it might elevate it to 7-8. You know, that being said, if that same tank, if I do 80% water change once a week, it'll probably never get very high at all. And so I should qualify that by our water here starts out at like 6.8 pH already, and so that's why it's not going to be high. Where if you start out at 8.0 where you live, then obviously you may not need crushed coral, or crushed coral might not help you, because if your pH is already higher than the melting point of the crushed coral,
right,
it's going to, you know, it'll always dissolve a little bit, but it'll be much, much slower, and I think that's where some of the crushed coral is great, it's terrible, you know, that type of thing comes from, is one person bought it because they said, oh yeah, African cichlids are great with crushed coral, and they already had high pH, And they go, well, it didn't get it to 9. And it's like, well, it's pretty much never going to get it to 9. That's not going to happen.
Right.
And then maybe we tell one of our customers that wants African cichlids to put crushed coral in. And they go, great, it went from 6.8 to 7.5. Amazing. I don't know why everyone doesn't use this. And, you know, so I think that's where some of the controversy comes from, is that depending on your structure of your tap water is how well it works. And there's other things that kind of come into play there, too. If you already have an insane amount of buffer but no pH, you know, or pH that you don't want, crushed coral might not be useful for you. Or if you have a ton of minerals in the water, it might be hard to get that crushed coral to dissolve already, because it's got to dissolve away to, you know. And I don't know exactly how the process works. Like, I know that crushed coral dissolves and it'll buffer alkalinity, but I don't know, you know, a lot of things when you're looking at chemical bonds. Like, to get one alkalinity ion that we use, it might have to shed 2 calcium ions, you know, or calcium molecules. And if the water already has the same amounts of calcium in it, it might not be able to shed those off, and so it can't break down. But yeah, so that's kind of the, you know, why some people love it, some people hate it. So let's say, you know, let's talk about other ways to change pH, I guess. Okay. And then we can talk about alkalinity also at that point, or at least ways we could stop stuff. Because it's, there's, you know, so I'm just beating around the bush here. pH up and pH down, you know. I'm trying to think why, you know, it's like rant alert time, you know. Like, we don't sell them in the store at all. And mostly because for those products to work well, they kind of naturally don't buffer the water. And we've kind of established that when we have money in the bank or lots of buffer, the pH doesn't change. So some of these products have to put in things into it that take away the buffer so that you can move the pH. And so if you, let's say you already had a lot of pH, but you wanted to be much more acidic because you wanted to keep discus, you naturally have to burn through all the buffer that you had, then drive the pH down, but that's where it ends. And so you might have your discus in there, things are going okay, but the pH is slowly creeping down because you used up all the buffer to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so that ends up becoming a problem, because then you're like, well, I stopped at 6.5, but how come when I went to do my water change, I was at 5.8? And it's because, well, fish kept going to the bathroom, wood was rotting, things like that. We didn't have any buffer. And the same thing can happen with, you know, pH up. So let's say you want an African cichlid tank, you've got our water, and we're not using crushed coral. We dump pH up in there, and we got it to 8.0. Okay, I'm happy with that. And then you test it 4 days later, and you go, wait a second, I'm down at 7.5. Well, we don't have any buffering capacity again, and every time that fish went to the bathroom and bacteria broke stuff down, pH started dropping again. So even if you're already high, it comes down. If you're already low, it goes lower, and without buffering capacity. And so that's what makes pH up and pH down dangerous, in my opinion, is that they don't tell you, well, I'm sure some do, but they don't, the hobbyist that uses it typically doesn't buffer the water when they're done with it.
Right.
You know, that's, I think that's the problem, is that they're, well, and I can say, you know, it's half the reason why we, for instance, don't recommend the master test kit. So the API master test kit, we use test strips because everyone gets into the hobby, everyone recommends they buy the master test kit, and it's called master test kit, and they test all those parameters, but one of the things it doesn't test for, I don't think it tests for alkalinity or hardness in that kit.
Mm-mm.
So, mineral content and the ability to buffer. And so they're so focused on getting the correct pH because they read about this fish that it needs. You know, let's say you read that you're new to the hobby and you want discus and you want to get the tank ready. And the pH listed on the website is 6.5. And so you buy some pH down, you get it down there, and you know, but you're not going to buffer it, and you're going to run into problems. And so what happens, like, why, explain why when people read on the internet the pH for fish, why it's pretty much always going to end disastrous.
Well, when they're giving pH recommendations it's all locality data. So it's like, oh, these fish were collected from this area. We tested the water, and it naturally ranges from this pH to this pH, roughly. And so if it's around neutral, then you're set. You don't have to, you know, as far as a wild-caught fish is concerned, if it's close to neutral, then generally there's not a lot of tweaking involved to acclimate them. I mean, but the thing is that most, or I should say a majority of the fish in the hobby, if they've been captive bred or farm-raised or what have you, they might be in water parameters that are completely different from what they are wild.
You know, I explained to customers a different location. Mm-hmm. So instead of, you know, this angelfish came from the Amazon, now it came from Idaho.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So it's literally that different, and it's like, well, what's the water structure in Idaho? Or what's that breeder keeping it at? Or, mm-hmm. you know, things like that. And so they get their tank all set up for discus, and they go when they buy the discus, or not discus, angelfish, I'm retarded.
Sure.
Hey, you don't know how to call me retarded. So they go and they buy these angelfish, and then like 3 days later, they're starting to get, let's say, like they're not looking so good. Maybe they're having some fin issues or something like that, and eventually we wrangle them in to bring some water in, and then they're like, oh, God, why is this pH so low? Well, that's what angelfish like. I read it. Oh, good Lord. And then, you know, so then it's the whole battle of explaining that what we're explaining right now of like, well, that fish, you know, was from Wisconsin, not from the Amazon.
Right, because, you know, fish breeders or wholesalers or what have you, they're not going to adjust all their water to match what a fish is used to in the wild, because they know that in a lot of cases it's already been raised in hard water, whether it's a discus or an angelfish or an African cichlid, that's pretty much all the same water. And so, which also leads to the part of the problem where it's like, you know, you're saying, yeah, you got a fish that in the wild are living in, you know, pH of 5.2, but you try to set that up in an aquarium and try to facilitate a nitrogen cycle and keeping bacteria alive, it's like it's not going to happen. And so your best, you know, it's best to let the fish adapt to your water parameters, and, you know, and keeping it in that kind of, you know, neutral to slightly alkaline water, and, you know, most fish will adapt to that water parameter. It's the extremes that cause problems, and it's because a fish tank is way different than, say, a natural biotope as far as how waste is processed, as far as the amount of water and, you know, the mineral content of the water, and so on and so on. And so it's kind of irrelevant to a certain extent what their water parameters are in the wild, because if you're dealing with something that, you know, the water parameters in your tank are only going to work within a specific range, and that's kind of the range you need to stay within to keep your fish alive, regardless of whether it's coming out of 9.0 pH or if it's coming out of 5.0 pH.
Yeah, and there's some problems of, you know, let's say you did want to breed like licorice grommies or something, you know, it's hard to breed, needs really low pH, some pistos that way too. Let's say it needs, you know, 5.0 pH to breed. Bacteria doesn't live at 5.0 pH. And so now you have a fish tank that filters can't do anything. The mm-hmm. fish still have to eat and go to the bathroom, but all you can do is change water. And the problem is you don't have 5.0 pH coming out of your tap. And so you're going to have to use an RO unit, things like that. But sometimes if you're starting with high pH already, the RO unit can't get it that high. So you got to use lots of peat and things like that. Get it super duper duper low.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, just so you can breed something, and, you know, but most people are never going to run into that issue. They're going to, you know, most people, and that's the thing you got to realize, most people, they have a fish tank and they just want some fish to live. That's what they're trying to do. They're not trying to breed. They're not trying to get the craziest rare things. They're like, I just want some African cichlid. I just want a goldfish. Is that too much to ask? You know, mm-hmm. that's the average person out there. And, you know, and I kind of thought of a good analogy for, you know, pH and alkalinity and stuff like that. You know, you said like, well, you'd rather have neutral to almost alkaline, and it's kind of like paying or having taxes held out for the IRS because most people would rather have them take out a little too much and get a little bit of money back and have that security than have it sneak up on you and go, oh God, I owe them $5,000? Mm-hmm. Like, I wasn't ready for that. And that's the buffer you have there. The more you have, or having pH a little bit higher than you need gives you more wiggle room. Whereas if you're running it right to the bone, if you made a miscalculation, you're going to pay for it. And, you know, and there are lots of people, I'm sure half the people watching this right now are going, these guys are idiots. Lake Tanganyika cichlids should only be at 9.2 or higher. Victorian should only be at this. Malawi should only be at 8.4. You know, and they're all are always going to be purists. But realize, you know, find out where the fish are coming from. Or, you know, you don't even need to know where they come from. Ask your fish store where you're buying them. What pH do you run? Are they doing well in their water? Great. Match that instead of going rogue and going way off the beaten path. And because, like, as a fish store, we assume most people are going to be more towards neutral. We don't, when we sell, you know, a discus, we don't expect that you have the pH at 5.8 already. We would expect, like, you probably have tap water is where you're starting, and our tap water is 6.8.
Right.
And things like that. So that's what we're going to assume. And when you're way outside of the norm, that can lead to problems because we didn't know you were doing that. It makes it hard for us to help you. So before I forget, I want to say that if you did need pH up, which you don't, but if you did, use baking soda. It's a soda bicarbonate. It'll raise the pH, and it also buffers the water. And in a pinch, when you really need buffering capacity, use baking soda. You get a lot of buffering and, you know, pH raising up, but not a ton. You can get a lot of buffer so it won't move around. And you might get like, okay, I've got 100 parts per million alkalinity, and it only raises the pH from 7.2 to 7.3. You know, so you can get a lot of stability. But the one time you make a miscalculation, you put 2 teaspoons in for your 100-gallon tank instead of 1, all hell is going to break loose, and, you know, it's going to be really bad. So that's why we don't recommend it, is, you know, a little bit goes a long way. A little dash will do you.
Mm-hmm.
And with crushed coral, there's downfalls to it, too. So baking soda works really fast and is dangerous. Crushed coral works really slow and is also dangerous in a way because... So typically, if we sell you some crushed coral, we go, well, it's going to take at least a week to see most of what it's going to do in your tank, at least, if not 2 weeks. And then, you know, the problem is, if you're doing lots of water changes, because it dissolves in slowly, you'll never get that high. And so, you know, goldfish people run into this a lot. They put crushed coral in to buffer the water and all those things, and they're doing, you know, 80% water changes every 3 days, and they go, this crushed coral doesn't do anything. And it's like, well... It can't with that much of water change. It's not designed to dissolve that fast. But if you're a person that, oh yeah, I change water every 2 weeks, or I change 10% every week, or I change 30% once a month, crushed coral in all those situations are probably going to help you. And you can figure out the ratio for your water that works well. Like what we recommend at the store, and this is you know, just what we found works and what we use in our tanks, is 1 pound of crushed coral per 10 gallons of water if we're sprinkling it in the gravel. Now, if you're putting it into a filter, it's going to dissolve at a faster rate. It's got higher flow-through rate. It also kind of run out faster. Mm-hmm. So it might only last 4 months as opposed to 4 years in the gravel. And so you got to be careful. You also, you know, you don't, if you put it in a filter, you don't want it to raise too fast either. And so, you know, that gets played with. So if you're putting it in the filter, it might only be 1 pound per 40 gallons or something like that. You know, you got to figure out what's going to work for you, and you're much better off going slow than too fast. And then also realize that if you do find out, oh God, my pH is really low, I got to fix that. You don't want to fix it overnight. You want it to take a while and slowly climb up. Like usually, if you're really bottomed out, I recommend people like, well, start doing 30% water changes every day, and your tap water will bring it up, and we're keeping the water clean, or just overall improving conditions. Then let's get some crushed coral in there. And, you know, once we got the pH where we want it, then we just want tons of money in the bank. Because then we don't have to worry about it, you know. And so you kind of get settled where you want to be. And then we get a lot of buffer in there. And once you have, you know,
$1,000 and you eat $5 a day, it's much easier to keep it at $1,000. But if you only have $10 and you eat $5 a day, you're constantly running out of running into problems, and it's really hard to get out of that cycle. So I'm trying to think of other things with pH and alkalinity and stuff like that to talk about.
Well, I mean, I was just going to mention that, you know, it's like, so where we are, you know, having the 1 pound per 10 gallon general rule, you know, even in our area can vary depending if you're in city water or if you're on a well or if you're living in up on a hill somewhere, or if you're living in downtown Seattle. I mean, it's all different. So, you know, the best place to start kind of trying to figure out your what you're going to need as far as keeping that pH and that buffer within that specific, you know, kind of neutral to slightly alkaline range. The first thing you need to do is test your tap water, because, you know, even though somebody in the Midwest or wherever might be listening to this video or watching this video, it's, you still need to test your tap water to find out where your starting point is, and so on and so on. And so, you know, as far as things that you can add to your tank, you know, things to look out for as far as what could cause potential pH drops or you know, alkalinity issues and things like that. I mean, it's essentially, there's a specific range that you kind of need to be within to keep a fish tank healthy and to keep everyone kind of up and going and doing what they need to do. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is, like, it's not, there's never just one simple answer. It's like you kind of have to take some responsibility and take a look at your tap water. And, you know, I mean, on the back of the test strip, it already shows you what you need to be looking for. So it's like, start at that point, and it's like, okay, well, yep, my pH is naturally a little bit low. And then you're going, okay, I'm going to try this amount of crushed coral and see where that gets me. And if it doesn't get you far enough, then you need to add some more. Or let's say, I mean, it's like, it's just one of those things where you need to pay attention. Like, it takes some proactive.
Yeah, it's not just, oh, I'm going to put this in, I'm going to walk away, and yep, that fixed it. It's like, well, we need to make sure that it's fixing it, and right, fixing it enough, or not too much.
Right, and it's a constantly changing equation, which is the other part of it, too, where, you know, you can put it in there, but it's not one of those, like, dump it and forget it, and then 2 years go by, and you're like, oh, I put crushed coral in there, but
the load in the aquarium changes. Like, you could have perfect tap water where you've got buffer, you've got the pH you want, all those things, and it worked great when your Oscars were, you know, little 2-inch guys, and now they're 14 inches, and your pH is 6.0, and you're just completely out of everything because the load going in on that tank is so much higher than it was a year or two ago. But, you know, a lot of people get lazy, like, ah, it's been running fine, the fish look fine, you know, and really you want to check in and just go, are they fine? You know, it's like human health. We typically don't go to the doctor till we're actually having a problem, you know. It's like, oh man, I think I'm having a heart attack, I should go in. Instead, it's like, well, we probably could have told you your cholesterol was high, you should exercise more for like past 10 years, could have avoided this. And you can do that with pH crash and things like that too. And I did want to bring up the pH scale is multiplicative. And so when we go from a pH that's 7 to 7.1, 7.1 is 10 times less acidic than 7. But let's say we go from 7 to 7.2. Well, it's 10, you know, so 7 times 10, or it's times 10 times 10. So 7.2 is going to be 100 times less acidic, and 7.3 would be 1,000 times less acidic. And so you can see how, you know, the kind of the rule of thumb that's been thrown around on the internet is 0.2, so from 7 to 7.2 or 7 to 6.8 is enough that it could start killing some sensitive fish outright. Now, you can imagine, what if I dropped in some baking soda and we shot from 6.8 to 7.4? You know, in the span of 40 seconds, you know, you can watch fish just whoop, you know, they're not ready for that. And so that's why, you know, I would maintain that stable water parameters are more important than the perfect water parameters.
Right.
You know, and even, because that's how you see, like, well, my grandma's got a goldfish, and the thing lives in orange juice, and it's been that way for 40 years. It's probably been stable orange juice, though. Like, it hasn't changed much.
You mean like and Tang, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, yeah, exactly. It's the same...
Orange juice.
The same, you know, Tang powder... Yeah, I'm trying to think of the right thing. Like, canister.
Canister.
Yeah, canister of Tang. She just puts a little bit in there each week. But, you know, as long as things don't change, stuff doesn't start falling apart. It's when stuff's just changing that it can't handle it. And, yeah... Long periods of time at a very acidic level might cause skin issues, might cause liver failure, kidney problems, things like that long term. Mm-hmm. In the short term, we just need to bring them out of that kind of stuff slowly when we do notice it. And, you know, so don't move it around quick. And, you know, I don't know when this video will air in relation to other videos I'm making and stuff, but I can tell you right now, I have wild caught orange laser corydoras over in the fish room, and they're laying eggs and breeding on crushed coral, you know, and the pH is 7.2. Yes, they are wild caught, but they are happy enough currently to be breeding, and if your goal was to buy a group of orange laser corys, now you may know that, oh, I don't have to mimic nature to get them to breed. You know, they just because that's what they are, and that's part of the problem, I think, is people think that where they are in the wild is the optimal thing. Like, I can tell you, you know, like, if you live in New York, the air quality is not optimal. Even though you could test it and you could be like, well, clearly they're used to that. It's like, well, yeah, but maybe we don't want them used to the abuse.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there's other things, other problems with collection data, as I call it. So typically, if you're going to go catch something in the wild, you're going to do it when it's the warmest time of the year because that's the most enjoyable time to get out there and catch something. You're probably not going to do it during the super cold rainy season where you're like, oh, I'm in the Amazon, it's only 68 degrees and it's a monsoon, you know. And so naturally we're going to report this higher temperature every time we've ever collected it in the dead of summer. It's this temperature. Oh, also, let's say it's not the flood season. Oh, we've got this many minerals, we've got this pH. Oh, and then if you were to collect in the flood season, it's completely different parameters. And so there's a huge range of what things accept. And that's part of the problem. But we tend as a hobbyist to lock on to, well, five different websites all say it should be 7.2. And the reality is those five websites are probably all copying the same source. They copy each other. They just go, yeah, sounds reasonable. I can recommend that. Why not? Mm-hmm. That'll work. And, you know, so take everything with a grain of salt, even what we say, probably like a, you know, not even a grain, like a big old scoop of salt, what we say. So naturally when we use things like, there's a few other buffers, like let's say Tanganyikan buffer, and like Victoria buffer, and Malawi buffer, and things like that. They're just salt concoctions that have buffering agents in them, a little bit of pH up, let's say, things like that. The things I really like to avoid are things like products called like Perfect 7 and Neutral and things like that, because I just don't understand how you can make a product that could take someone that had 8.4 pH or 6.4 pH, and it magically brings it to 7. You know, it's basically like, put 4 scoops in, we'll fix water. You know, it's
right.
Like, yeah, I don't know about that, you know. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's really, as far as the locality data, in some cases it's helpful, and then in a lot of cases it's misleading or completely irrelevant to what you're trying to do. I mean, in reality, you know, these fish in the wild have just adapted to live in a specific area. So, you know, I mean, you know, do you need to recreate the harshest environment on Earth to keep these guys happy? Generally not. You know, that's why things, you know, invasive species, you know, so the, say you have an animal that comes from a very extreme area, it's adapted to living in that environment. You know, it's adapted to the food supply. It's adapted as far as how big the fish is going to get or whatever it is. And then you take it and put it in an even more ideal environment as in, oh, there's way more food. The water conditions are way more tolerable or way more even beneficial. And so that's also going to increase how many other fish or how many other animals or plants are living in that same environment. And then all of a sudden it's like, you know, this animal that used to have to struggle is now like, you know, sitting at the open buffet, and that's how they just start replicating like crazy because they have that advantage of being able to survive in harsh conditions. And then they're just able to completely overtake another species that has kind of had it easy, so they don't have to try that hard in comparison. So,
yeah, I never thought about that. That makes a lot of sense, you know, to make that argument of we want to keep them in optimal parameters. But, you know, what you just stated there, it's like you can watch something thrive way better than it ever did in its natural habitat as it's invading somewhere. And that, you know, I feel like to me, you know, let's say that Jack Dempsey or whatever replicates at a certain rate specific to the area it comes from, but then in this trench in Florida, it's doing way better. It's like, well, I feel like I got a measure that's doing way better. I'd almost say those water parameters are better. You know, right. it's hard to quantify that, but at the same time, I had never thought about invasive species on how sometimes they can do way, way, way better where they're not naturally from compared to where they are. And there's things like, let's say we go collect some gudgeons in Mexico that are about this close to being extinct.
Mm-hmm.
Is that water we just took them out of, is that optimal when we basically killed them in, let's say, the last 60 or 100 years? Or does it take longer for evolution and really their body would really love a different water parameter if the water's not? You know, mm-hmm. can it catch up that fast? I don't know that answer. You know, but we assume where they come from is optimal. Like there's some killifish you pull out of the water that, you know, oh, it's a drought year. There's barely any water. Is that the optimal water or is that one out of 12 years is that dry?
Right.
You know, but no one collects it that often. So that's the data we got and that's the data we're going to keep.
Right. And they're obviously not going to be looking for fish in a dried mud puddle. So unless right. they're scooping out eggs or something.
Right. Like. And then so the other thing. You know, when we're looking at why are we even look at this data, it's because it does help you. I mean, obviously, if you have a fish that lives in 9.2, it probably won't thrive at 5.8. Probably. I mean, it might. You know, don't get me wrong, but it at least puts you in a direction you should be going. And usually we run into that with guppies and swordtails, all the live bears that like harder water and higher pH. Typically really just don't do well under 7. You get much under 7 and they really just start struggling. And, you know, so even though that you can go, oh, this one comes from 7.8. It doesn't need 7.8, but it can't have 6.8.
You know? Right. I mean, in my observation, so say with, you know, live bears that prefer harder water, or I should say like lots of mineral content in the water. And so it's like, you can slowly start to decrease the mineral content. But it seems that you start running into issues as far as crooked backs, because I think a lot of times, well, if you're depleting the mineral content out of the water, well, then there's less minerals for these fish to consume and use to grow and to keep their bones from mm-hmm. curling up from lack of calcium. And I think, you know, some of these fish that have adapted to live in harder water, well, then they don't need to metabolize as far as pulling, you know, the calcium and the other types of minerals out of their food, because it's just in the water at all times. And so when you start to slowly take that away, they start to suffer because of it. You know, they're low birth rate, you know, they start developing problems as far as metabolizing or start getting crooked backs and all kinds of weird stuff. And so it's kind of like, well, you know, you can still have lots of mineral content in the water without having crazy extreme hard water or crazy extreme pH. It's just got to be enough to keep it within a specific range that's going to keep your bacteria in your tank happy you know, keep a certain degree of maybe plants happy and then also keeping the fish happy all at the same time. And I've also noticed with more, you know, with fish that are generally found in more acidic or low mineral content environments, you can still have a certain amount of mineral content, but to counteract the harshness of all those minerals in the water, which say like in the case of a betta, where it's like, oh, the water's like rock hard and their fins just start to deteriorate. Well, sometimes you can counteract that destructive or corrosive or what's the other word I'm looking for? Caustic reaction. Well, sometimes by adding catapa leaves or driftwood or something where there's tannins being released, it seems to help kind of counteract that hard mineral water. And so so it's like you're counteracting
the negative
effects. The negative effects by counteracting with the positive effects of the tannins. Yeah. So I've noticed that with bettas where it's like, hey, you can still keep a buffer and you can still have decent mineral content, but then you start plunking more leaves in there and they seem to do fine. So.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the way with like, you know, other like opistos or rams or what have you. It's like, well, to maybe counteract some of that hard water, just load it up with lots of tannins and that seems to help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. So, I don't know, there's much more. We got to figure out what pH we're going to do in this aquarium behind us.
It's 5.2, right?
Yeah, all right, fine. Yeah, we'll do 5.2. And
at what pH does acrylic start to dissolve, I guess?
Yeah, so this, we listen to you guys. You want to look, you know, you want to look at a fish tank. So, you know, we're looking for ideas. We think it needs to be something big. I thought about, you know, doing like just one pea puffer or something, you know, like you'll never get to see it. But we don't know what we're going to do yet. I thought, you know, ideas we thought of, like, oh, maybe it's a big puffer fish, maybe it's goldfish, maybe it's blood parrots, you know, it's too small for an arowana, it's, you know, who knows? Like, I can do discus, except I don't want to do discus because I'd have to way heat it out here and do a lot of water changes, so that's out. It does have overflow, so we can put a big sump on it if we want. It's about 150 gallons, and then we might put a 55-gallon sump, so it might be like 200 gallons of water. It's a 5-foot tank. It's a little bit odd, so it's like 22 inches front to back. It's not quite, it's more than 18, and it's pretty tall. We specifically were looking for a tall one so that, you know, my fat melon wouldn't block the entire thing. It only blocks like this much of it, so, yeah, so we'll take some ideas. I don't want anything crazy high maintenance, because otherwise we're just going to make videos where you sit and stare at our backs as we're cleaning the tank, because we don't have any time, you know, so we don't want to show off a bad looking tank either, but, you know, so we don't want to do crazy high tech planted tank, you know, and I just don't know that on camera 500 cardinal tetras will look that cool when they're only, you know, this big, and it'll be a mass moving, but, you know, I kind of want like a big dove eye or something that'll just like attack Lamont every time he sits down or something. You know, train him to hate him or something. That'd be kind of fun. But so if you guys got some ideas, you know, put them down in the comments. Everyone obviously has got their own flavor, what they like. And, you know, whether we like it or not, we'll try and weigh some ideas on what we think is going to work out here. I mean, obviously cool water is better because I'm not really heating the space yet, but I can heat, you know, the aquarium, put some heaters in there, and I'm a little afraid of small fish just because we do have two overflow boxes, and if I do like a ton of dwarf hatchet fish, you know, they're just gonna end up in the sump, so that won't work either. You know, we also considered doing a turtle tank, you know, so we could do turtles as well, and, you know, we're passionate about turtles, but we're not sure if you guys would hate us if we talked about turtles, so let us know. Are you interested in turtles or aren't you? You know, it's still water quality and things like that, and we just know there's like, well, in my opinion, not that much high quality water turtle videos and information out there. I mean, there's some information out there on websites, but like in terms of YouTube videos, I feel like it's pretty sparse compared to fish.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's hard to say what's out there and what's not out there, because I think a lot of times with turtle videos, they just kind of end up in the nether regions of YouTube, and people have to try and find them or sure. dig deeper to get to them. But I think that, yeah, overall there's a general lack of information as far as turtles and stuff are concerned. But, you know, it's one of those things, in my opinion, is important, especially since there's so many species of turtle that are either, you know, quickly becoming extinct or near extinct or endangered and so on. And also exportation of turtles is starting to get more and more strict, and they're making it harder and harder to get stuff. And even on a, you know, here, like on a state level, there's so many laws as far as, at least in Washington state, as far as what turtles and stuff you can keep. And so the door is quickly closing as far as access to a lot of wild-caught stuff or being able to get wild-caught stuff. And so a lot of habitat destruction and so on and so on. So I guess what I'm trying to get to is that, you know, conservation of turtle species is pretty important.
Right, which with the turtle or reptiles a lot of times is kind of different than fish. Like, if Lamont, the turtle nerd, doesn't pick up a turtle and breed it, like, it might just not be out there in the hobby. Like, that's the problem. It's like, oh yeah, no one cared enough to really breed them, and they're just gone, you know?
Right.
A lot of the fish, we really nerd out and care about them, and we, you know, really lobby against dams and things like that, but some turtles are just like, yeah, it's a turtle, they're all over the place. Like, holy shit, where'd those turtles go? There's literally, like, none to be found now.
Right, well then, and that's, you know, so it's like, say, buying a turtle retail, it's like, well, in Washington State, it's what, the 4-inch law, I believe. Mm-hmm. So it's like, oh, well, it's got to be over 4 inches. And then, so you start running into the situation where stores don't want to carry, obviously they can't bring turtles in if they're under a certain size. And so that just wipes out a huge swath of species to choose from that in the wild don't get much bigger than 6 inches. And so it's like, well, we could sell those species, but then you're basically buying full-grown adults, and so a full-grown adult cost versus a hatchling cost is a huge difference, especially when it gets down to a species that needs to be bred. Or,
well, and especially when it gets to tank size, like, all of a sudden it's like, this is an insane setup to be doing this, and all of a sudden it's like, I'd like to own a turtle, like, oh, $700 to get into this? Like, I just want a turtle,
right,
you know?
Right.
So that's why you see a million red-eared sliders for free on Craigslist, and everyone's got them in a 20 to 40 gallon tank going, oh, I don't know what I'm going to do. The turtle water's always bad.
Right, and then,
which, I mean, crushed coral helped that too, by the way.
And tannins, yeah. Yeah. But, I don't know, I mean, it's like, just to find turtles for sale in a retail establishment or pet
besides
store.
Besides like a red-eared slider.
Besides a red-eared slider, or besides an African side neck, or besides maybe like a yellow belly slider or something like that. I mean, your options are very, very limited. And unfortunately, red ear sliders are one of the hardest kind of higher maintenance species of turtles to start with.
You know, from not being the crazy turtle guy, like, I do love turtles, but I'm not like super turtle guy. I feel like the red-eared slider is the common plecostomus of the fish world. It's just like, oh god, everyone's got one that's too big, and there's not enough homes, and, you know, it's like, oh geez. Like, it's great on one level, but, you know, anyone who's got big enough tanks that wanted red-eared sliders already got more than they want, you know, and there's not enough homes and things like that, so that's why it's a problem.
Right, right. I mean, so a lot of it comes down to just the wrong species being available to the general public, and people just not knowing what they're getting into.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of like, you know, if the pet stores were able to sell a turtle that magically can live in a 55 gallon its whole life, then it would be great. But unfortunately, red-eared sliders are not one of those turtles.
And there are turtles that totally fit that description. I just can't legally sell you one. That's the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So I would, you know, understanding as much as we can right now about turtles and how to keep a turtle tank and how, you know, getting into things as far as food and, you know, supplementation and all that kind of stuff, it's, you know, it's now or never. So
especially if you want to hear more from Lamont, just get him talking about turtles or snakes or something. This guy loves that stuff. And I don't know that. I mean, I know enough to keep my own animals alive, but I'm not, you know, I know a lot about fish. This guy knows a lot about a lot of different turtles and tortoises and crap like that that I know nothing about. You know, I know basics of water quality, and that, you know, that gives you a leg up when you're going from fish to turtles or whatever. You, in general, if you can keep really healthy fish tanks, you end up being like a turtle god just because you can manage your water quality, and they... You know, it's like, oh, this rare slider poops like 10 Oscars at the same time, you know? And so it's a different load and things like that. But if you guys want to see some of that kind of stuff, we'll totally do it because I love geeking out about turtles. You've seen some turtles in my fish room, you know? You know, saw some in Lamont's house. So, you know, we could talk about them. And, you know, maybe we'll get one going back here. Who knows? You know, we like to mix turtles and fish, which that's, you know, it's more episodes. And here's how you do and don't do that. And here's what you got to be ready for. And, you know, things like that. And the last thing I want to bring up, it's starting to happen. It's kind of the Team Aquarium Co-op, as I'm now dubbing it, where people are starting to recommend our videos to, let's say, novices or people with questions. Like it happened today where someone was asking, like, how does a sponge filter work? And should I get one for my tank? And someone linked our sponge filter video, which was awesome. We make these videos for the information, and the fact they're actually making their way to the people with the actual questions, you know, makes it all worthwhile. So, you know, you can kind of join Team Aquarium Co-op and just link a video to when people have a question when it answers that. So, like in this video, if someone is having horrible problems with their pH and they're on, you know, let's say the Tank Talk forum or your local club forum or whatever it is, go ahead and link this video. And if they watch it, they should know a lot more by the end of it. Doesn't mean they understand it. Doesn't mean we even said everything you need to know. But it might be better than a couple people leaving a couple of sentences going, here, try this, try this, try this, you know. So you can be part of the co-op team and be helping us do those kinds of things. You know, there's always, like, if you're bored and you want something to do, I've got a job for you. I can't pay you, but I got a job for you. Like, you could be, you know, we desperately need someone to transcribe our videos. Like, if you, you know, type out all my rants, then people for the, you know, hearing impaired and things like that can get the information, which that's a big, you know, a big, not market, because it's not profitable, but there's a section of people that need that. Or, you know, the studies say that people want to watch this, like, in the library, because they don't have internet access, but they don't want it blaring on the speakers, or they want to watch it, you know, like, maybe you want to listen to us, but you can't, because your wife's sleeping right next to you, and she hates that, and you can read it, you know, so there's, and sometimes... You know, I know for sure for, like, the fish room videos and stuff, you know, we'll rattle off a species name and people go, who's it, what's it he called that thing? You know, so we get that a lot in the comments. Like, what'd you say at 37 minutes and 14 seconds? And then we go, oh, yeah, that was, you know, Labdochroma ceruleus. You know, it's a yellow lab. And so if that was all transcribed out, that would help. You know, we need thumbnail pictures and graphic work and all that kind of stuff. But Team Aquarium Co-op, we're just doing our part, putting the information out there. If you guys want to help us spread it, we appreciate that. And, yeah, I think that's pretty much all we got. It's probably, could be a long episode. I don't know. I wasn't keeping track of time. I was rambling. So, you know, I think until next time, make sure you check out our other videos. Let us know what you want to hear about. Let us know what you want to go in this aquarium. And,
personally, I'd prefer maybe some kittens in there or something.
I think a high-tech hamster tank.
There you go. Like a hamster amusement park. Can we do that?
We could do that. That would be awesome. So, anyway, let us know. We'll catch you in the next video. We do appreciate you watching, and it's probably time for us to go to bed. It's getting late. We worked all day. So, all right. Later.
Bye.